Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here. So my name is Patrick Navarre. I'm working in a research center dedicated to materials processing, and we are deeply involved into various aspects of biomass-based polymers. Today what I will do is I will describe a new French project that is dedicated to establish a new crop in France. So this has this very ambitious title. I didn't put the title myself. I don't like this title, Biomass for the Future. That doesn't mean much. Okay, and then I will describe what we are doing there. You will see that it will touch some of the questions that were raised all over the 1 day and a half, and it will show how we are trying to somehow answer these questions. So I will first briefly describe the context of the project. In fact, not really briefly. There will be a few slides on which I will stay a bit more. I will describe this project, what it is, and I will simply give a few results just to illustrate. But that's not really the purpose of my talk, is not to give you the results. In any case, we are at the beginning of the project, but more the philosophy or the approach. And you will see it will make some connection with previous talks. So mainly, the drivers behind are the ones that were also said by many other speakers about the fact that we do have, in fact, land that could be available to grow plants that could be used for making products out and not for making food. And there is some land that are accessible for that. We do have a large amount of lands in France that are not really suitable for growing plants for food. And there are somehow two types we are targeting. And that's true mainly, for example, around the city of Paris. One are the highly polluted lands, simply because Paris is a large city, and for years and years and years, the municipal authorities were simply dumping in some areas all the waste. So there are a huge amount of lands that are not really accessible. There is another driver, which is different, which is the fact that very soon in France, maybe in Europe, I don't know, but at least in France, all the water catchment areas, the place where the water is, the rain water is falling, and that water will go down under the earth sort of underground lakes that will be used for drinking water, all these areas, the farmers, they will not be able to use pesticides or fertilizers. So in these areas, there will be a lot of restrictions soon, in about 2 years, I think, to use that for food, because you need a lot of fertilizers and a lot of ingredients to have really a good production. So there are some land, quite a lot in France, a few percent, that is really available for that type of things. So this is the drivers. The second driver of this project is that although over years, there were a lot of adaptation of plants for food. And there is here an example of maize, or US of corn, where you see the production per, it's not really per hectare, but that doesn't matter, per some surface, as a function of years. I don't know if you can see that here it's 1860 and down to 2020, or no, 2020 here. And you see that there was not a lot of improvement up to 1940, 50, where, of course, genetics and biology really moved very much up. You see here the figure is 20, here the figure is 140. Now, with 1 hectare of land, we can collect a lot of food. Of course, there are some side effects of that, as you know. But that's the plants were really highly adapted for food. But they are not adapted for materials, never. So there was no driver for that. So that's the second driver. Why not to adapt plants in the same way it was adapted by using modern biology tools? So this is the second driver. So what will be this Biomass for the Future project? This is a very large project. There are 24 partners. It was established about a year ago, but really in reality, it is so complicated. It started only about 6 months ago. It involves university research centers, that's very classical. It involves companies in various areas. And we call here companies even farmer associations, they are called there, and that's very important, local communities. Because we will establish a new crop, and if we establish a new crop, it starts from land management to agriculture, all the chain should be there. It's a long project, 8 years, because the crop, they had to be improved, and it will take time. And of course, it costs a lot of money. The project is about 30 million of euro, only financed by France. So this is a very ambitious project. In this project, I'm in charge of all the valorization part. So the two objectives, we targeted two plants. Miscanthus, it's sort of bamboo that is not naturally growing in France and growing in Asia, and sorghum, which is a beet growing in France. So these are the two plants that are targeted, and the idea is to develop these two plants as a sustainable plantation in France on large areas with all the valorization chains. Okay, everything should be in, from land management down to applications. We, for the time being, focused on four applications: heat generation, anaerobic digestion to produce methane, bio-based construction materials, mainly bio-based concrete to make houses, and plastics. So that's the target, and of course, that will be done by the creation of new varieties and new culture systems. And on the 30 million euro, a lot of money is on the biology side. Okay, there will be a lot of people that will look at genetics, at biology, at phenotyping, to try to tailor new genotypes. I call a genotype a variety of the plant. Okay? That will have some criteria. It can be tall, it can be wide, it can be without this amount of lignin, that amount of hemicellulose. So this will be a genotype. It will still be the species Miscanthus, but with many genotypes. And we will target, we will improve that with, of course, improved lignocellulosic yield. We'll try to grow as many amounts of plants, dry matter per hectare as possible, but also, and that's very important, reduced environmental footprint. For example, the criteria is no pesticide and no fertilizer. So that's the real target. So these two plants are what? They are sorghum. This is an annual plant. It means it has to be planted every year. Every year you are putting the seed and it will go again. It has a large yield, about 20 tons of dry matter per hectare, and it is rather resistant to dryness. So that will be targeted for the south of France. It is really efficiency using water. So that will be for the south of France. For the northern part of France, for the time being, it's not adapted to biomass-based material production. Okay, that's not made for this for the time being, only for feed. For Miscanthus, this is a perennial plant. It means you are not planting every year. As soon as you plant it, you put it, you put the rhizome in the earth, it will stay like that for, let's say, 10 to 15 years. So you when you plant, you must be sure that you will keep it for a long time. It has also a large yield, about 15 to 18 dry matter, tons of dry matter per hectare. It is adapted to northern France. And the reason is that it needs water at the time where it is raining a lot in France, in the northern part. And it is a plant coming from Asia and Africa. So it's a wild plant. So it has never been adapted to any application. So when you use Miscanthus, you use just a wild plant. It has never been adapted. So there is a lot of potential to adapt it from a biological and agricultural point of view. So what is the problem to establish this? You have two sides in life. You have the size here, the side of the agronomy, the biology, the genetics, where you will have to, work on the plant. And you have the other side, the industrial uses. So you see that there, we have to combine many different persons, many different scientists, many different types of companies. When you put in the same room a car manufacturer and a farmer association, you know, they have to find a common ground to speak about and to discuss. When you are, as I'm part of one of the work package, I'm taking care of this one. When I'm meeting with my colleagues, you know, I may have sometimes complications to understand what they are speaking about when they start to go deeply into genetics or phenotyping. That's not exactly my culture, but I have to manage this. And in the same way, they have to understand what I'm speaking about, extrusion or injection or whatever, or making concrete or whatever. So this is a very important part of the project, this discussion, and this ability and capability to discuss. Sorry, I'm just looking at, okay. There is another driver behind, is that the companies, it was already said several times, the companies that are involved and the new companies that are joining, they will only develop the material if they are sure that there will be a production around. And the around doesn't mean 600 kilometers, because then the LCA will tell that it's not okay. The production should be local. Okay, otherwise that will not work. It will cost a lot of money for transportation. So they must be sure if Peugeot, which is part of this consortium, or Renault that will join, they will use miscanthus in their car as a composite. They must be sure that they will have so many tons of miscanthus at a given price that will come. But the farmers, they have to plant, cost a lot of money. It costs 3,000 euro per hectare about to plant. And they are starting to collect the first harvest, or the harvest, after 2 years. So they have to be sure that when they will plant, spend money, they will have companies ready to buy, and over a long time. If these two criteria are not met, it's a failure. And this is what is blocking a lot of projects. That's why here it's so important that in the loop, everybody is there, including local communities. Because, of course, to decide that this area will be planted for non-food, that's land management. And that's under the hands, not of farmers or not of companies. That's the hand of the local authorities that will decide this area will be dedicated to that application, and all that must be organized. And this is rather complicated and very interesting. I'm a normal scientist. Okay, so I'm taking care of research center and my group. And here we are, I'm entering a new world. How we will combine all that and be part of this wide arrangement. If you heard the Novamont talk, that's what they do when they started to link farmers to this ENI, old former factory. That's, if there is not this loop around with everybody involved, this is very complicated. So this is the old strategy. That's why it is so slow. It took 2 years to build it. And it's now slowly becoming effective. And I'm sure it will work, but it will take a lot of efforts by everybody. Okay. And the farmers, they want a certain price. The companies, they are not sure that this price they can cope, and so on. So these are the discussions which are outside pure science, let's say. Okay, so now let's move a bit more to science, and I will finish with this. Okay, so you see all the various work packages. So you see that there is only one really dealing with the applications. Okay, and so what are called G1, G2, and G3? That's the generation one. So that's the miscanthus you can buy now, and this is the one we are using now for making all the tests. But of course, from these tests, with all the different available genotypes we do have, we will try to channel to all the production, which is agriculture or agronomy, and all the ecophysiology, genetics, and breeding strategies for trying to improve the, of course, the plant. One also good advantage we do have, and that's as a scientist is something very interesting, we do have a lot of research centers in agronomy that are planting for us what we want. Now, this is very interesting. I will come to that a bit later. So this is the way it is organized. Okay, so now I will touch one point only in two or three slides. The point is the following. My friends in agronomy, they are planting, let's put it like this, it exists 21 different genotypes of miscanthus. If you go all over the world, you collect, some are small herb, some are huge bamboo of 4 meters high, some are very wide, some have a lot of lignin, some have, okay, they are all different. They managed to collect all over the world 21 genotypes, different variations of the plant, and they planted that for us. for us, I mean for my group, in fact. So they decided to take some hectares where they planted all this. And this is something that was sent to me with a mission which is very simple. Please evaluate which one is better in terms of polymer composite. And this is not so straightforward because usually that's not how we are behaving. Usually when I'm making a composite with flax or hemp or whatever, I'm collecting flax. I don't know which genotype it is. I don't know who collected it. I don't know what is in. Now here, I know everything about my genotypes. And that's the challenge. And the challenge is not so easy, you know, because that's for Miscanthus. But you see, I received also 43 of sorghum and 17. And we have to prepare polymer composites and evaluate here their mechanical properties, which will be related to genotype characteristics. Okay, so which means that the genetic print, the internal structure of the plant, and the composition. But for this, we must be sure that any change we will see, is due to the plant, to the genotype. Nothing else from receiving the plant down to making the composite. So that means that we had, and it took about 6 months, to define and test a robust procedure for each step of the process. We have to prepare the fiber, so we had to harvest it. We are checking the harvesting. Okay, so even my PhD, my postdocs, they went to cut maize recently themselves to be sure how it was done. We have to dry it, we have to condition it, we have to store it and to be everything the same way. Then we have to mill it in small pieces, and we have to sieve to say we will all test, let's say, a 5-micron length fiber. And then we will look, we have to process again, we have to determine the mixing conditions, we have to determine the fiber content, the fiber length. Everything should be precisely defined in a robust way. And then we will have to measure the mechanical properties. For example, to this end, we had to reconsider what is a test bar. You know, there is all the norms of STM, whatever, test bar with a certain shape. We changed that to maximize the effect of the filler. So our friends in the mechanical department, they redesigned and recalculated a special mode for this. So this is what we are doing. I will not give you really scientific results. I think that's not the point of this presentation. I wanted simply to tell you that first we are engaged into this large project. We are also open for collaborations. If you have some ideas to use either Miscanthus or sorghum, and if you are interested by using these different genotypes, testing them, there are a lot of rooms for collaborations. We have to see under which conditions, but that's really a lot of room for collaboration, either from an academic point of view, which is easy, or from even an application point of view for companies. There is no problem. I would like to thank Jordi, who is one of my postdocs, who helped me to do the work on the mechanical properties. The three companies here are the three ones that were involved into the composite, polymer composite business. And with this, I think that's my last slide. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions for Dr. Navarre? Okay, one down there.
Thank you for your presentation and good luck for the project that you have. I suggest it's one short question. I saw you were intent to use the maliated polypropylene as a coupling agent. So that means that you will use a synthetic matrix. Do you have in mind to use a bio-based material for this?
Okay, so the purpose of the work is to compare the influence of genotype. It's not at all to prepare a very good composite or to prepare a fully bio-based composite. We are not interested by this. We are interested to see whether genotypes for a given species, a given variety of plant, has an importance or not. So, of course, for this work, we selected some coupling agent that was what we call robust. It means that we found with different genotypes and various, let's say, minor differences in the in the mixing conditions the same result. So that it means that it's not influencing any small detail of or variation of something in the process is not changing the final result. But of course, that is nothing to do with the material that will be developed in future. Okay, so this is only for testing the influence of genotypes. So we are open and we have, other, of course, ideas like you and on other coupling agents that could be, for example, bio-based. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. So the screening of the different genotypes, the effect of the different genotypes is a preliminary kind of step in this project.
It is the first step. So okay. Either, but we don't know the answer, nobody did this. So either it has no influence, which means that you take Miscanthus or you take sorghum or you take maybe flax or whatever, finally there is not much difference in the genotypes that are available, at least without genetic manipulations, which is a problem. Is of course a condition in Europe, or at least in some countries in Europe, but in France it is an absolute condition. You cannot manipulate, you can only breed, you cannot do GMO plants. So either there is a difference, in that case by breeding the plants will be ameliorated, or it will be a better condition, or there is no, maybe, and that's, it could be, there is no difference. Mm-hmm. In that case, the project will focus on other areas. Yeah.
Okay.
That can be, that there is no importance. So in that case, the focus will be on yield and on, mm-hmm. on environmental conditions more strongly.
Okay. So thank you. Another question.
Just more general. We have been promoting more than 15 years the concept of biofuels. And the first generation of biofuels was criticized because it's against the food. We are taking food, transforming into biofuels. The second generation was in much better position because in principle we are using non-food resources or waste from the agricultural production. My question is, in your case, how you did you meet some opposition or criticism that in principle you are going to use agricultural land? I'm right, or you intend to, I mean, more general, not the specifically to what you are presenting, but in general, that project for 30 millions of euro. There were some oppositors to that saying that you are going to compete with agriculture or not?
Not yet. Not yet.
Okay.
But doesn't mean it will not come. The issue there is not really if we are using a plant that can be used for food or not. For me, this is not the issue. The issue is which land are you using, mm-hmm. whatever is the plant.
Yes.
If you are planting on a polluted area, maize, that corn, that can be eaten, but of course when it is planted in a polluted area, you cannot eat it. That, for me, is a sort of non-food mm-hmm. crop.
Okay, it is clear. Thank
so,
you.
So yes. That's clear, this, yeah.
Okay.
And we don't know what will be the opposition for this. We are very careful. There are other issues, I have no time, but there are other issues from environment, that, like mm-hmm. invasivity. Fact that some of these genotypes, they are invasive, so they
can spread
everywhere.
Around.
They will
yes.
spread everywhere. So we are, of course, selecting the ones that are not doing this. But it's difficult to explain to the general public this. Okay, mm-hmm. the difference is delicate.